only come out of it. So both are unidirectional, but this is a purely hypothetical subject, hypothetical object, not yet experimentally object. Then there are some objects like neutron stars, boson stars. We have been, with our research group, we have been making publications on that, very wonderful. You might have found them in the some American journals reported about our work. Anyway, so neutron star is a compact star. It's one of the densest materials, one of the densest objects in the sky, in the universe. So its radius is roughly 11-12 kilometers. And just imagine, if you take two of similar objects or matchbox, and you fill one with the material from a neutron star, you fill one of them with our Earth rocks. Now, one would be a few trillion times heavier than this one. Okay, so that is the thing, and they rotate very fast, almost 700 times per second, or 43,000 revolutions per minute. So they emit some in the process. They emit some electromagnetic radiation called as pulsars. They were detected exactly 60 years ago. Please note up. I will take just 5 minutes more. Okay. So have patience.
Please don't discuss.
So they were observed exactly 50 years ago, and this we have gone through. This I would like to show. This particular one here, we have put the coefficients of dt square and dr square of a particular specific form. This would describe a black hole, soft shell black hole, non-rotating, non-charged. So this thing is zero. When this becomes zero, r becomes rs, the soft shell radius, and you obtain. So this metric describes. This was written down exactly 101 years ago. Okay, just 1 year after the Einstein equation was written, this Mr. Schwarzschild had solved this problem. If you add this additional term, you can describe charged black holes. Similarly, there are other possibilities to describe rotating neutral and rotating charged objects. And this, you know, we can escape the Hamilton's variational principle through which you write down. This is some concrete work. It's not everything is hypothetical. We are talking real thing. This is, using this, we have half a dozen good, very leading research people in this field. This is Ricci scalar, this is cosmological constant, this is electromagnetic field, this is complex scalar field, and this is some potential. And with this, taking this, this is kinetic energy minus potential energy is called a Lagrangian. You need to know that only, kinetic energy minus potential. And if a particle is moving from one point to another point, it can move with infinite possibilities, but it chooses that particular path for which the x and h minimum. Okay, so delta s is zero. This is the variational principle. And so if you use appropriate action, then, and you choose the ds square, this is the square of the interval between two. I sit in a helicopter and I fire my pistol once, and after some time I again fire my pistol. What happens? Then these points that we were talking about, distance between 2 points, now we talk about distance in these events, which is called separation. Separation in these two events. So time is also there, therefore events, not only points, but space time. So the square of this interval, that is called ds square. And it has to be invariant with respect to all the frames. Okay. So if you choose it correctly, if you choose the boundary conditions effectively, for example, like if you put b equal to 0, you can solve it. If you make the sign here opposite sign, you can describe wormholes. If I choose appropriate boundary conditions, with this I can describe black holes. With the same thing, I can describe boson stars, which consist of bosons. Or if I add Fermi fields here, I can describe neutron stars or a mixture of these exotic stars. So this is something doable and something experimentally very beautiful. Okay, it's not hypothesis. Okay, so this is the kind of equations that one we talked about then. The last two are Klein Gordon equations, this is Maxwell's equation, this is Hilbert Einstein equation, this is energy momentum tensor. Only just to give you an idea that what I am talking is real, okay, it's not hypothetical. At the end, you obtain some equations of motion and you solve them numerically. Some bright people, our research student, they are very bright, genius student. So because you cannot solve them mathematically, analytically, therefore you solve them numerically using advanced numerical techniques, and you can find good solutions. I would not have time to show them to you, but you can discuss and talk about this. Now, a wormhole idea is a compact region of space-time, with a topologically simple boundary, but a topologically non-trivial integer. Let me show it to you in a pictorial representation. Let me first go forward and then I will come back. So, let me first show you this thing. This is a simple periscope. I think all of you have constructed it in school. Okay, you sit in underwater. In a marine, you have this one end here and the other end here. You are sitting under water, but you are able to see outside the surface of water. The periscope, everybody knows, constructs it at the school level. So now, it's a generalization of this idea, and this is... So, supposing here is our mother Earth, our solar system, and I want to go to the nearby solar system called Alpha Centauri, then I can construct a wormhole, a passage like that, where normally you may have to travel like that and it will take you some light years. I mean, the distance you have to travel would be of some light years. Here you can construct a short path and you can travel from here to here. This would be a shortcut to traveling from one point in space-time to another point in space-time. Here it's a little bit better depiction that the space-time here is curved and here also curved. And you enter one end and you come out at the other and vice versa. This is also called Lorentzian wormhole. You can enter one hole and so one of the mouths is accelerated at very high relativistic speeds with respect to the other. In principle, actually, if you measure the time here and here, synchronize the two clocks, you enter here, you can even come out at a time prior to the time that you enter. Okay, which would amount to backward time travel. And, well, both backward and forward time travel, it's possible. You can go from one universe to another universe, or one solar system to another solar system, or from this room to my room in my hotel. So, any short or any large distance, you can connect two different space-time points. So these wormholes connect two space-time points. This connects two universes, and this connects two space-time points in the same universe. Now, this is a pictorial depiction for a wormhole. Time travel to future, yes, it's allowed. Time travel to in the past, yes, allowed. Method of transport, yes, allowed. Information is allowed. Technologically viable, no. Then you are needed. So here the young students are needed to make it technologically possible. Okay, if everything is correct here, and if I have some one or two more diagrams to show you, this is a computer simulation of a wormhole created by students actually. This is a real one created by somebody in Germany in the University of Tübingen, and it connects someplace in France. And the wormholes can be converted into a time machine. So I cut short on all the stories, and here is some. Here is a cat who has discovered a wormhole. Okay, and here is Mr. Neil Armstrong, the traveler in Apollo 11. But that allowed only space travel. So you have to think of a machine which also travels in time. For example, Mr. Neil Armstrong landed there in July 1969. Now, can you construct a machine which will take you back to July 1969 at the same space-time point? again standing on the moon at the same site where Mr. Neil Armstrong was standing in 1969 July. So you need that. And then all these ideas, this book was written in 1895, very famous book, some of you might have read it, by H.G. Wells, Time Machine, you can find it on the internet. And with that, I would like to conclude my talk, and I'd like to thank you all very, very much. I thank you all very much for your very, very kind patience to hear me. I have overshot my time by 6 minutes, Praveenji. I apologize for that. I overshot by 5 minutes.
Yes, any questions from the student?
No, sir. No, sir. No, sir.
Yes.
Okay.